Spinosaurus has got to be one of the most interesting enigmas in all of paleontology. With every new discovery since it was first dug up in 1912, it seems to always take on a new form. So I thought it would be a fun idea to go through the entire history of the sailback from its discovery to the most recent paper about it. Now disclaimer, I probably might get a few facts wrong here and there, so do be sure to correct me in the comments for any wrong information. I did my best to be thorough with my research, but I am only human after all. So, without any further ado, let's begin! The first specimen of this dinosaur was discovered in 1912 in the Bahariya formation in Egypt, but it wasn't until 3 years later in 1915 where it was formally described by German paleontologist Ernst Stromer, giving it the name Spinosaurus aegyptiacus, meaning Egyptian spine lizard. This first Spinosaurus specimen consisted of partial remains documented in a now famous picture. These consisted of a part of the lower jaw, a few teeth, its iconic neural spines, and a few other fragmentary parts of the body. The nature of this discovery combined with the view of dinosaurs at the time led to a radically different interpretation of what Spinosaurus could have looked like, as opposed to what we think it might have looked like now in the modern time in light of more recent discoveries. However, despite that, it was thanks to this discovery that we were able to get a clear idea of the appearance of Spinosaurus, as even later discoveries would prove even more fragmentary than the holotype. This specimen already depicted the unusual appearance of Spinosaurus compared to other dinosaurs, and yet things would only get stranger and more confusing going forward. Before that, however, tragedy struck. The Spinosaurus remains were stored in a paleontological museum in Munich, and for 30 years it was safe and undisturbed. That all changed on the 24th of April, 1944. It was during World War II, and on that day, the British commenced a bombing raid in Munich. The museum and the fossils it contained were among the casualties of that fateful day. Despite the tragedy that had befallen the holotype specimen, not all was lost that day for Spinosaurus, as Stromer's son donated his father's archives to the museum once it had been renovated. Thus is the reason we know of the Spinosaurus holotype at all. In fact, for the next half century, it was the best we had regarding Spinosaurus. Turns out Spinosaurus was a rare find in the African desert, even rarer still, being specimens that consisted of more than just a few individual fragments. Thus, for a large portion of its history, Spinosaurus remained largely a mystery, with the few fossils discovered only providing a brief glimpse into the animal and the world it lived in. It wasn't until 2008 where a new light would shine on Spinosaurus. In 2008, paleontologist Nizar Ibrahim was approached by a fossil hunter while conducting research in the Kemkem beds in Morocco. The fossil hunter showed him a collection of fossils, one of them being a partial Spinosaurus. It wasn't until a few years later that Ibrahim managed to track down where the fossil had been discovered, and an expedition was launched to uncover the specimen. The events of this find was documented in the documentary Bigger Than T-Rex, which, by the way, let me know if I should review that documentary. It was with this new discovery that marked a new chapter for Spinosaurus. Formally described in 2014, this new specimen consisted of parts of the skull, vertebrae, forelimbs, pelvis, and most interestingly, its hind limbs. Turns out Spinosaurus had much shorter hind limbs compared to other theropods, making it even weirder than it already was. Furthermore, this was when the semi-aquatic Spinosaurus theory really picked up traction. It was found that the hind limbs were incredibly dense, which may suggest that it would have helped the animal sink when hunting prey in the water. This, however, is still to this day a very controversial topic, and trust me, that will be a trend for Spinosaurus from here on out. It was also briefly hypothesized that Spinosaurus could have been a quadruped and walked using the knuckles on its forelimbs due to calculations at the time showing the center of mass of the animal being more forward heavy. This hypothesis, however, was quickly dropped in the following years. Despite the continued debate sparked from this discovery, it is undeniable that it was a crucial and significant leap forward in our understanding of Spinosaurus. The next leap in Spinosaurus discovery came during an expedition in 2018, where once again, Nizar Ibrahim made a breakthrough. Being formally described in a paper published 2 years later, a specimen which includes the tail of Spinosaurus revealed brand new characteristics. Turns out Spinosaurus was even more spinier, as the tail exhibited tall neural spines, much like those on the animal's back, and it is theorized that these spines formed a sort of paddle-like shape. This new discovery then led to the semi-aquatic hypothesis gaining even more traction, with Spinosaurus being suggested to have been a capable swimmer and may have actively hunted prey underwater like a crocodile. However, this hypothesis is still heavily argued, as an opposing theory was made that Spinosaurus would have instead waited on the shoreline for fish to swim close before snatching it up, without having to necessarily do any swimming. A couple of other papers regarding Spinosaurus was also published around this time, including those analyzing the buoyancy of Spinosaurus compared to other theropods, a paper analyzing the oxygen isotopes for semi-aquatic behavior in Spinosaurus, which basically means they were testing how much time different Spinosaurids would have spent in the water, and a paper discussing the effectiveness of the new tail discovery in providing propulsion. Moving forward from this discovery, the next 4 years leading up to the present day is a time where Spinosaurus would have a major makeover, pretty much after every new paper analyzing it was published. So be prepared. 2021 was a time that mainly continued the debate surrounding the two hypothesized lifestyles of Spinosaurus, with a paper by David Hone comparing the probability of both. This paper attributes the more shoreline view of Spinosaurus as the wading model and the more semi-aquatic swimmer as the pursued predator model. This paper does a very thorough examination of all the features of Spinosaurus and testing which hypothesis will be supported based on the characteristics of the body part being analyzed. Everything from the skull to the hind limbs to the paddle-like tail was analyzed. And honestly, there is way too much information for me to summarize in this one section that would also give an idea of how detailed the paper is. So instead, I've left a link in the description down below of the paper for you guys to read for yourself. It's a very interesting paper, if I do say so myself. As you probably should expect, the debate only gets more heated in the following year. In this section, I'm going to cover two papers which discuss both sides of the debate. Coincidentally, one being published at the beginning of the year, and the other one publishing at the end of the year. Talking about the first paper first, this paper supports the pursued predator model of Spinosaurus. This paper was led by paleontologist Matteo Fabbri and a whole bunch of colleagues, including Nizar Ibrahim. The main discussion point of this paper was analyzing the bone density of almost 400 different animals, both extinct and extant, to find a correlation between bone density and what they call subaqueous foraging behavior. In layman's terms, it means how well adapted an animal is at swimming to catch food. It was found that deep diving animals, including marine reptiles and whales, actually have a lower bone density than shallow water animals, including Spinosaurus. Summarizing a bit, a high bone density was found to have a correlation with subaqueous foraging. However, other anatomical features must also be considered when writing a conclusion. Using this correlation on Spinosaurus along with two of its relatives, Baryonyx and Suchomimus, it was found that Spinosaurus almost certainly exhibits subaqueous foraging behavior based on its bone density. Interestingly, Baryonyx also exhibited similar bone density to Spinosaurus, which, based on this paper, indicates that it too is a subaqueous forager. Additionally, Suchomimus was not found to be very subaqueous, as its bone density was more similar to other terrestrial theropods compared to its relatives. Now, you might think this paper is pretty conclusive. Spinosaurus followed the pursued predator model and swam like a crocodile to catch fish. However, there is a whole other paper quite literally titled Spinosaurus is not an aquatic dinosaur. So yeah. Story is far from over. The second paper, led by Paul Sereno, tests the accuracy of the aquatic hypothesis of Spinosaurus. The main points of this paper is that all the known Spinosaurus remains were CT scanned and combined to create a new model of Spinosaurus that is used throughout this paper to analyze the aquatic hypothesis. I'll spoil it a bit, but basically this paper supports the wading model hypothesis and they provide a bunch of evidence as to why. So they start off by noting the differences between their model and that of previous papers, specifically the 2021, where the aquatic hypothesis was initially proposed following the tail discovery. A lot of data found were similar to that of previous papers which supported the wading model, such as buoyancy and stability of Spinosaurus when swimming. Furthermore, the adaptation of the hind limbs were suggested to be for weight bearing rather than subaqueous foraging as was previously suggested by Fabbri's paper. The tail was also suggested to not be an effective paddle due to its lack of flexibility. This paper also found that Spinosaurus was a lot smaller than previously estimated, being around 14 meters and 7.4 metric tons, as opposed to the previous estimate of 16 to 18 meters and 7 to 9 metric tons. Now, that's the main gist of what the paper covers, but there's still a lot more talked about in the paper than I have time for in this video. So once again, I've left a link in the description for you guys to read the paper on your own. So yeah, 2022 was quite the year when it came to Spinosaurus debate. Now surprisingly, 2023 was a relatively quiet year for Spinosaurus itself. However, it was definitely not quiet for Spinosaurus as a whole. There were a bunch of new species described in 2023, and also a bunch of studies on other Spinosaurus genus. One of these new studies included a pelican-like Spinosaurid hypothesis. Yes, that is a thing, as if Spinosaurus couldn't get any weirder. But yeah, while this year was rich with Spinosaurid studies, Spinosaurus itself took a backseat from the spotlight, though it didn't stay out of the front page for very long. And now we have made it to the most recent paper of Spinosaurus, which, surprise surprise, refutes previous papers on how Spinosaurus was a swimmer, specifically the 2022 Fabbri paper. This new paper, which by the way was published as recently as last month, re-examines the methods and data used in the 2022 paper and essentially criticizes the methodology used within that paper. Now, if you want the full detail, go read the paper yourself from the link in the description, but essentially, they see that the conclusions of the 2022 paper, specifically regarding the subaqueous foraging behavior of Baryonyx and Spinosaurus, were not as safe and sound when compared to the dataset used. This new paper, however, doesn't exactly add anything new towards the understanding of Spinosaurus and mainly criticizes the Fabbri paper, but they did support the conclusions that were made by Sereno's 2022 paper of what Spinosaurus' lifestyle could be like. Also, already the authors of the original Fabbri paper are working on a response to back up their conclusions within that paper. And that's the entire history of Spinosaurus. Now, as you might have noticed, in the over 100 years since it was discovered and described, a lot of what we know about Spinosaurus now came from discoveries and studies within the past 10 years, which means for a majority of its history, Spinosaurus remained largely a mystery save for the few fragmentary remains discovered. So it was really thanks to the discoveries made by Nazar Ibrahim that we are now able to get a much clearer picture of what Spinosaurus is, even though aspects of its lifestyle are still far from settled. Honestly, I think the only way to really settle the debate is to discover a fully intact skeleton of Spinosaurus, though given from what we've seen in its history, that discovery is still probably quite a ways off in the present. But you never know, perhaps a stroke of luck will unveil the true nature of this fascinating dinosaur. Until then, the debate will continue, and I'm sure the next paper published on Spinosaurus will cause it to have a complete makeover again. Who knows, it might be discovered that the seal can actually charge up and it can spew atomic breath. And as much as I'm joking, you can never really know what Spinosaurus, can you? Anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you did, be sure to leave a like and subscribe, and let me know if I should do this type of video covering the history for other dinosaurs. But for now, I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye.